everybody. So there is sometimes some confusion around the difference between two types of treatments that I do, and in part because both of them are injections and both of them use dextrose. And so I wanted to take a second here to talk about the difference between perineural injection therapy, which uses a low concentration dextrose, and prolotherapy, which is going to use a higher concentration dextrose. So, as I already said, both of these are injections, and so we're using needles to basically place the dextrose in particular areas to try and have a certain effect on the tissues that we're injecting. And so, first let's look at perineural injection therapy. So, perineural injection therapy, the ultimate goal is basically to get neurogenic inflammation or nerve inflammation to calm down. Now, there are different substances that can be used, but I'm mainly just going to talk about the kind of our baseline substance, which is a 5% dextrose solution that we buffer so that it has a neutral pH. And the current, it's not 100% understood exactly how this works, but kind of the current research is showing us that basically this 5% dextrose has an impact on potassium outflow from a particular potassium ion channel called the TREC ion channel, which result in alterations and changes in the TRPV1 ion channel. Now, the TRPV1 ion channel is the ion channel that basically secretes substance P. Now, when substance P is secreted into tissues, our brain will perceive this as pain. And so by decreasing the amount of substance P that is released from these TRPV1 ion channels, we can actually decrease the perception of pain in the brain and help patients kind of resolve their pain through that mechanism. Now, generally these are subcutaneous injections, so we're using like a 1/2-inch needle. In some instances, I might use a little bit of a longer needle, a 1 to 1.5-inch needle, if I'm trying to get a nerve that is piercing through a deeper layer of fascia that's a little bit deeper. But usually this is all gonna be palpation guided, just because a lot of these nerves that we're treating are actually insanely difficult to see under ultrasound guidance because they're so small. And so because of that, we use palpation techniques and we cover a little bit of a wider area with our injections. Now, contrasting that with prolotherapy. So prolotherapy, the origin for the word comes from proliferative therapy because we are helping tissues to proliferate. So whether it's a ligament, a tendon, a cartilage, things like that, we are, the ultimate goal essentially is to have fibroblasts increase the production of collagen. And so that way there's more collagen fibers, which is then going to strengthen ligaments, tendons, and things like that. And so the substance we use is still dextrose. However, generally our proliferative therapy or our prolotherapy starts at around 15% dextrose, which is very different than the 5% low concentration dextrose that we're using for perineural injection therapy. Where we're injecting for prolotherapy is generally going to be the enthesis. The enthesis is the medical term or the technical term for where tendon and ligament attach onto the periosteum, which that periosteum is attached to the bone. And so these tendon ligaments don't actually attach directly to bone, they attach to the periosteum, and the periosteum attaches to the bone. And so this kind of continuous connection between tendon, periosteum, bone, or ligament, periosteum, bone, is called the enthesis. And that is where there can be a lot of pain coming from when we have these chronic conditions of the ligaments and tendons. And so we use the needle to advance down, and usually this is gonna be in my clinic under ultrasound guidance. We use the needle and we advance down to this enthesis, and then we inject the higher concentration dextrose solution anywhere between 15 to 25%, depending on what structures we're treating. And that will help to increase the fibroblast production of collagen, so that way we can have an impact on patients' pain. And so, so that's kind of the difference in how both of these kind of work. Now, the other different aspect of this is actually the response times. So with perineural injection therapy, because we are basically having an anti-inflammatory approach to the nerves, what we see is that patients will generally feel better immediately after the treatment. And so it's pretty common for me in my practice that I will do my testing, figure out, okay, I think this is a nerve issue, and then we'll treat that nerve, and immediately after the treatment, so within kind of 2-3 minutes, I'm retesting those things that were painful before and helping to use that to kind of guide me to say, was this effective? Was I down the right path? And generally what we see is, because of my screening process and my selection process for who should get these injections, is that we see those painful exams are no longer painful, showing me that we've addressed some of that neurogenic inflammation. And so what we see is we see a big positive response, and then over time, that can wear off because the neurogenic inflammation can kind of creep back up and kind of build again. And so when we compound treatments over time, what we see is a slow reduction over these multiple treatments until we can get the pain to resolve. Now that's different than prolotherapy. Prolotherapy, generally what's going to happen is most people are going to be a little bit sore for a few days afterwards, because we've gone in and we've injected a little bit of a more tender area, being the enthesis. And because we are re-stimulating a new healing response that has to go through the inflammatory cascade, that healing, what generally happens is we get a little bit worse, and then we have this slow climb of getting better that with prolotherapy generally takes anywhere from 3 to 8 weeks, with usually the average being about 4 to 6 weeks. And then what'll happen is at some point a patient will plateau in their healing, and if they wait long enough, they'll either stay that way or they might have a slight regression, but then when we retreat, we can continue to compound on that, so that way we can see some longer term benefits. So while both of these solutions use dextrose and a needle, there's a big difference between perineural injection therapy and prolotherapy, and it's important to understand those differences, because understanding those differences allows the doctor and the patient to make better judgment calls on which therapies might be most indicated. I hope that helped give you guys some clarity on the differences between these two therapies. And if you have any questions, don't hesitate to ask. See you later.